Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Angel in the Whirlwind, The Triumph of the American Revolution, by Benson Bobrick. Narrated by Malcolm Hillgartner. We know the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong. Do you not think an angel rides in the whirlwind and directs the storm? John Page to Thomas Jefferson, July 20, 1776. Preface. A great many books have been written on the American Revolution, and quite a few of them are good. I have not written mine to try to supersede them, or out of some general dissatisfaction with the canon, but, hearkening to the voice of my own ancestral heritage, to retell the story in my own way. It is such a remarkable story that to do so scarcely needs excuse, yet it made a difference to me in the writing that I was bound by lineage to the tale. My colonial forebears, English, French Huguenot, and Dutch, had fought and died on both sides of the war. The English, stem and branch, were the Bakers. My middle name is Baker. The Dutch, the Bensons. The French Huguenots, the Valois. Some had been in America since 1649, had settled New Amsterdam and New Rochelle, served for three quarters of a century in the King's American Wars. One perished in the Schenectady Massacre of 1690, but when the Revolution came, were divided against themselves. The Bakers, as far as I know, were all staunch patriots, but within the Benson and Valois families, brother stood against brother, father against son. At least two served in the Continental Army, three in Loyalist troops. One of the patriots, Isaiah Valois, was captured by the British, imprisoned in the Sugar House, a major site of incarceration, in New York City, and there succumbed to starvation and disease. His younger brother Peter remained a loyalist to the end. One of the loyalists, Matthew Benson, an officer in the King's Orange Rangers, had his property expropriated by his brother John, who became a patriot judge. Matthew's eldest son was killed by patriots in battle. John's son witnessed the execution of Major John Andre, Benedict Arnold's co-conspirator, at Tappan. At the conclusion of the war, Matthew Benson and Peter Valois were both exiled with many other loyalists to the Cataraqui area of Canada West, north of Lake Ontario. Matthew sailed on July 4, 1783, with his wife and surviving children from New York City on the British transport Hope, wintered with some 400 other refugees in canvas tents at Sorel, northeast of Montreal, and in the spring of 1784, proceeded by bateau up the St. Lawrence River, dragging the boats by hand up numerous rapids to Adolphus Town on the Bay of Quinte, where they arrived on June 16, 1784. In the beginning, Matthew worked as a millhand, and during the hungry years, survived in part on flour dust swept up from the floor. Peter Valois also settled in the Cataraqui region, and there in 1801, his daughter married Matthew's son. In the historic Whitechapel graveyard outside Picton, Ontario, every third or fourth headstone bears the Benson family name. Meanwhile, the Bakers had remained in the States, were eventually joined by marriage to the Valois-Benson line, a reconciliation in my blood, and came down squarely on one side of the second Great American Divide. My great-grandfather Benjamin W. Baker stood in the audience of one of the Lincoln-Douglas debates, and at age 18, at the beginning of the Civil War, answered Abraham Lincoln's first call for volunteers. He served in the Union Army until the war's end, was wounded three times, once severely, and after one battle, Chickamauga, I believe, buried his younger brother, who had fought and died beside him on the battlefield. After the war, he became a Methodist minister. His son, my grandfather, became a bishop of the Methodist Church, and as chairman of the International Missionary Council, was authorized by President Truman at the end of World War II to undertake a goodwill mission to Japan. Received by General MacArthur on October 26, 1945, he was the first American civilian after the surrender to set foot on Japanese soil. President Eisenhower also valued his counsel, but such are history's long divisions that his son-in-law, my father, ended up on Nixon's enemies list. Were Nixon's loyalists all patriots? One may doubt it, but these are changeable terms, and so I trust my loyalist forebears will forgive my own patriot bias in what follows, though I have tried not to slight their point of view. If I have, I may be guilty not so much of disloyalty as of some lapse in my patriot strain. Part 1. Chapter 1. The Beginning of the End. On July 4, 1754, a young major adjutant general in the Virginia militia retreated through mud and rain along a forest path as the defeated remnants of his expeditionary force staggered under the weight of the sick and wounded on their backs. A month and a half before, they had crossed the main ridge of the Allegheny Mountains to do battle with the French, and they had lost. Now they were going back. In the developing frontier struggle for the domination of North America, this critical reversal would cost the English such credibility with their long-standing Indian allies that in the following year, when the smoldering conflict burst into flame, nearly all the Western tribes drew their scalping knives for France. For the Virginia Major, it was perhaps the darkest day thus far of his young life, and it threatened an early and inglorious end to his career. That major was George Washington, who was 22 years old at the time. But Providence had assigned him a very different fate, and, by its adumbrations, had foreshadowed his later triumph in the day of his defeat. Since 1690, there had been three wars between the French and English in Europe, and each had rippled outward to the contested margins of their empires. In America, the cycle of violence had begun on February 9, 1690, when French soldiers and Indians, sweeping out of the forest, had fallen on the sleeping village of Schenectady, New York, and massacred the inhabitants. At the time, the French claimed almost the whole of North America, from the Alleghenies to the Rocky Mountains, and from Mexico and Florida to the North Pole. These vast regions, with adjacent islands, they had grandly christened New France. The English, rather more modestly, claimed a string of colonial holdings on the Atlantic seaboard, but these they convincingly held. Most of the French settlers, about 75,000 in all, were trappers and traders who operated along the Mississippi and St. Lawrence rivers and seldom ventured to the farthest reaches of their theoretical domain. The English, on the other hand, had more than a million colonists, farming and creating growing towns and communities from Georgia to Maine. Geography protracted the contest. In Canada and the American interior, it was hard to maneuver with decisive force and speed through forests or marshes, across mountains, or down rapids or streams choked with fallen trees. To some extent, such terrain also rendered the numerical superiority of the English unavailing, since in actual encounters, the numerical advantage often lay with the French. Moreover, the inability of the colonies to unite on almost any issue made it difficult for them to coordinate their efforts at defense. One Swedish visitor remarked, "It happens that in time of war things go on very slowly and irregularly here, for not only the opinion of one province is sometimes directly opposite to that of another, but frequently the views of the governor and those of the assembly of the same province are quite different, so it is easy to see that, while the people are quarreling about the best and cheapest manner of carrying on the war, an enemy has it in his power to take one place after another." King William's War, begun by the Schenectady Massacre, came to an end in 1697 and, after 5 years of an uneasy peace, was followed by Queen Anne's War in 1702. That lasted until 1713. It was succeeded in turn by King George's War, from 1744 to 1748. Nothing had been settled. The French remained entrenched in the vast interior, where they fortified their positions, consolidated their alliances with various Indian tribes, and at strategic points along the main tributaries of the Ohio River, sank or buried engraved lead plates claiming the territory for France. By 1753, they had begun to link French Louisiana with Canada by a chain of forts in a strategy designed to prevent the English from extending their settlements westward beyond the mountains, and thus to hem them in between the mountains and the sea. The English viewed these encroachments with some apprehension, but in the international rivalry between the two empires, the development of sea power and the promotion of commerce assumed priority over all other concerns. Both France and Britain had established trading posts and ports of call in India, along the African coast, and in the West Indies, in an effort to control both the slave trade and the European traffic in Oriental goods. They valued their North American possessions primarily for what they could harvest or produce: fish, fur, and naval stores from the north, tobacco, sugar, rice, and indigo from the south. Sea power was essential to protect the distant trade routes, which meant not only the expansion of their respective navies, but the establishment of naval stations at strategic locations like Gibraltar on the Mediterranean or Louisbourg on the Canadian coast. In North America, French and British commercial interests confronted each other on the seaboard of Acadia, extending from Nova Scotia northwestward to the St. Lawrence Basin, the area about Lake George and Lake Champlain along the Hudson-St. Lawrence River route between New York and Montreal, the Great Lakes Basin, and the Ohio Valley, which Virginia claimed even as the French moved to secure their access from the north. Late in 1753, in response, the royal governor of Virginia dispatched Major George Washington with a diplomatic protest to the French regional military commander at Fort Leboeuf. When the French refused to withdraw, he sent Washington back early in the following year with militia and a company of British regulars to evict them. This was the beginning of the French and Indian War. By this time, the French were securely ensconced at Fort Duquesne, on the site of modern Pittsburgh. Near Great Meadows, a level tract of grass bordered by wooded hills, Washington surprised a party of Frenchmen and opened fire, killing the French commanding officer and 20 men. Shortly thereafter, the French surrounded him in a hastily constructed log stockade, appropriately dubbed Fort Necessity, and on July 4, 1754, they forced him to capitulate. Washington could scarcely be blamed entirely for the defeat. Promised reinforcements from North Carolina had never arrived, and those from New York, arriving late, had crawled towards the scene of action with thin ranks, bad discipline, 30 women and children, no tents, no blankets, no knapsacks, and for munitions, one barrel of spoiled gunpowder. Over the next several months, in the face of colonial inaction, the French gathered, like so many locusts, in pockets of the contested terrain. France and Britain now poured in regular troops and roused their respective colonists and Indian allies. The Five Nations, or Iroquois Tribal Confederation, cast in their lot with the English, the Algonquin tribes with the French. New Englanders rallied creditably to the side of the king's troops, but contributions from the middle and southern colonies, which had the most to gain, were negligible in proportion to their population. From the Ohio Valley, the war rolled northward, at first primarily as a counter against French aggressions, but eventually amid the Great Lakes and wooded mountains of New England and western New York, and on the wild coasts of Nova Scotia, it evolved into a contest for Canada as well. The British went on the offensive, and in February 1755, disembarked two regiments of regulars at Hampton, Virginia, under the command of General Edward Braddock of the Coldstream Guards. He proceeded up the Potomac to Alexandria, where, together with several colonial governors, he mapped out a campaign. The French were to be attacked at four points at once. Two British regiments and a force of about 450 Virginia militia were to advance on Fort Duquesne, near the confluence of the Monongahela and Allegheny Rivers. Two provincial regiments to reduce Fort Niagara in western New York, a combined body of provincials from New England, New York, and New Jersey to seize the stronghold at Crown Point at the southern end of Lake Champlain, and another body of New Englanders to capture Beauséjour and bring Acadia in Canada into subjection. Braddock himself was to lead the expedition against Fort Duquesne, but despite his enthusiasm and his record of success in fighting clansmen in the Scottish Highlands, he was not the right man. Benjamin Franklin, who was assigned the logistical task of rounding up wagons and pack horses for the march, wrote, "Braddock might probably have made a good figure in some European war, but he had too much self-confidence, too high an opinion of the validity of regular troops, too mean a one of both Americans and Indians. In this, he was typical of the British officer corps. He also thought the campaign would be easy. I shall hardly need to stop more than 3 or 4 days at Fort Duquesne. Then I shall march on to Niagara, and from there to Frontenac," he told Franklin. When the latter tactfully warned him of the danger of ambush, as "the slender line, nearly 4 miles long, which your army must make, may be cut like a thread into several pieces," Braddock replied with a smile, "These savages may indeed be a formidable enemy to your raw American militia, but upon the king's regular and disciplined troops, sir, it is impossible they should make any impression." Braddock also paid little heed to the seasoned frontier advice of Washington, now a colonel, who accompanied his expedition as an aide-de-camp. "He looks upon the country, I believe, as void of honor or honesty," Washington wrote at the time. "We have frequent disputes on this head, which are maintained with warmth on both sides, especially on his, as he is incapable of arguing without it, or giving up any point he asserts, be it ever so incompatible with reason or common sense." Washington already had plenty of first-hand experience with the presumptions of the king's men. When he had been trapped at Fort Necessity, reinforcements had arrived under a Captain Mackay, bearing a royal commission. Mackay, however, in a fatal separation of their forces, had refused to acknowledge Washington as his superior in command. On the 10th of June, Braddock set off from Virginia's Fort Cumberland on his march over the mountains. His heavily laden wagons were dragged with difficulty up the steep and rugged roads, and his supply train, extending for 3 or 4 miles, contained many articles of artificial necessity, inappropriate to a backwoods campaign. One pack horse, for example, typically carried 6 pounds of loaf sugar, 1 pound of green tea, 1 pound of bohea tea, 6 pounds of ground coffee, 6 pounds of chocolate, 1/2 chest of white biscuit, 1/2 pound of pepper, 1 quart of white vinegar, 2 dozen bottles of old Madeira wine, 2 gallons of Jamaica spirits, rum, 1 bottle of powdered mustard, 2 well-cured hams, 12 cured tongues, 6 pounds of rice, 6 pounds of raisins, 20 pounds of butter, and 1 Gloucester cheese. A full month was thus consumed in marching about 100 miles, which slowness evoked the irrepressible sarcasm of Horace Walpole, who wrote, "General Braddock does not march as if he is at all impatient to be scalped." Meanwhile, most of the 100 or so Indians he had taken with him as scouts had deserted in the face of his abuse. Washington advised Braddock to divide his forces, leaving one part to come on with the army's stores, baggage, and more cumbersome appurtenances, and the other, light artillery and his elite troops, to advance rapidly on Fort Duquesne before it could be reinforced. 1,200 men were selected for the attack, but "I found," wrote Washington, "that instead of pushing on with vigor, disregarding a little rough road, they were halting to level every molehill and to erect bridges over every brook, by which means we were 4 days in getting 12 miles. On July 9, Braddock at last crossed the Monongahela River, about 10 miles from where Fort Duquesne stood. A rough path led before them over open, level ground until it curved along the base of a line of steep, forested hills. On either side of the path were thick, wooded ravines. Braddock neglected to send out scouting parties well in advance of his soldiers to reconnoiter the flanks, but instead advanced through the clearing in the greatest order with his whole force, their bayonets fixed, colors flying, and drums and fifes beating and playing, as if in a review in St. James's Park. At 2 o'clock, French and Indians rose out of the woods. The Virginia troops immediately scattered and took up positions behind bushes and trees in a skirmishing style of fighting with which they might have held their own. But Braddock absurdly ordered them back into line and formed his regulars into platoons. Thus arrayed as easy targets, but unable to see the enemy themselves, they wasted their ammunition while enemy bullets poured with impunity into their lines. Even more terribly, many of the Virginians were slain by the blind British fire. At length, the regulars lost their nerve completely and began rushing frantically about. "When we endeavored to rally them," recalled Washington, "it was with as much success as if we had attempted to stop wild bears." Braddock rode back and forth in the thick of it all on his charger and, after four horses were shot under him, mounted a fifth. Washington was no less brave. Indeed, his coolness, courage, and knowledge of Indian warfare were chiefly responsible for the preservation of the surviving troops. Though he escaped unhurt, two horses were also killed under him, and four bullets pierced his clothes. Retreat alone spared their forces absolute annihilation. When the battle was over, 750, or two-thirds of the British and American contingent, including three-quarters of its officers, lay dead or wounded, while the Indians and French had lost just 51. Braddock himself had taken a bullet in the lungs. To expedite the long march back to Fort Cumberland, much of the baggage train, including cannon, munitions, and equipment, was discarded or destroyed. Provisions were scattered through the woods and swamps. Indians afterward gathered up much of the equipment, grenadiers' caps, canteens, bayonets, and so on. And as they drifted into Fort Duquesne toward nightfall, one eyewitness remembered, "It seemed to me that almost every one of them was carrying scalps." Braddock, failing fast, was silent throughout the first day of the retreat, and at night said only, "Who would have thought it?" On the following day, he said merely, "We shall better know how to deal with them another time." Then he expired. He was deliberately buried in an unmarked grave in the road, so that all his men, horses, and wagons would pass over the spot, effacing every sign of it, lest the Indians should find and mutilate his corpse. Washington's subsequent account of the debacle was scathing. "The dastardly behavior of the English soldiers exposed all those who were inclined to do their duty to almost certain death." Years afterward, Benjamin Franklin remarked facetiously, "This battle gave us the first suspicion that our exalted ideas of the prowess of British regular troops had not been well founded." Of the three other British campaigns of 1755, only the attack on Fort Beausejour in Acadia was successful, but it had little strategic bearing on the war. Braddock's defeat left the long frontier from Maryland to Pennsylvania exposed, and, with the encouragement of the French, the western tribes now attacked the border settlements with seeming impunity. "No road is safe," wrote Washington, as scalping parties came to within 50 miles of Philadelphia. Not far from the Moravian town of Bethlehem, Indians fell on the village of Gnadenhutten and massacred the inhabitants. By fall, the whole frontier was in a panic, and the French commandant at Fort Duquesne was exulting that prisoners of every age and sex were being held by his Indian allies. The fate of many captives and other settlers was cruel. "The Indians kill all they meet," admitted one French priest, "and after having abused the women and maidens, kill them and scalp the children alive." Meanwhile, on August 14, the Virginia Assembly had appointed Washington its commander-in-chief of militia, and in that capacity, he undertook the almost impossible task of defending the 350-mile-long frontier. At his disposal, he had just 1,500 men, and the insufficiency of this force drove him almost to despair. "The supplicating tears of the women and moving petitions of the men," he wrote, "melt me into such deadly sorrow that I solemnly declare, if I know my own mind, I could offer myself a willing sacrifice to the butchering enemy, provided that would contribute to the people's ease." By 1756, the conflict, which had begun in the backwoods of America, had spread to the rest of the world. In May and June, England and France formally declared war on each other, and, in what came to be known as the Seven Years' War, allied themselves to various other European powers. They preyed upon one another's shipping, clashed directly or through surrogates on the European mainland, and met directly in India and North Africa and on islands of the sea. In the wilderness of North America, it was an abominable kind of war, wrote one Frenchman, in which insensibility and hardness seemed to infect the very air one breathed. In addition to the British regulars that came over in waves, some 20,000 Americans took part in the fighting, including a special corps of American Rangers made up of independent frontiersmen of particular toughness, daring, and skill. As they prowled the woodlands, summer and winter, day and night were alike to them, wrote the great historian Francis Parkman. Embarked in whaleboats or birch canoes, they glided under the silent moon or in the languid glare of a breathless August day, when islands floated in a dreamy haze, and the hot air was thick with odors of the pines. They were there in bright October, when the jay screamed from the woods, or squirrels gathered their winter hoard, and in the tomb-like silence of the winter forest, with breath frozen on his beard, the ranger strode on snowshoes over the spotless drifts, and, like Dürer's night, a ghastly death stalked ever at his side. For 2 years, the British commanders, first John Campbell, the Scottish Earl of Loudoun, and his successor James Abercrombie, proved ineffectual, while the French found strength and assurance in their brilliant general, the Marquis de Montcalm. Montcalm took Fort Oswego on the south shore of Lake Ontario, the most important of the English outposts, and a year later destroyed Fort William Henry at the southern end of Lake George. For his part, Abercrombie led an army of nearly 15,000 British regulars and colonial militia to ignominious defeat at Fort Ticonderoga, where on July 5, 1758, he allowed almost his whole force to be cut to pieces by Montcalm before the fortress walls. Then the tide turned. William Pitt was appointed the British War Minister, eliminated incompetence from the General Staff, and chose Geoffrey Amherst and James Wolfe for his American command. Before the end of 1758, Louisburg, Fort Frontenac, which controlled Lake Ontario, and Fort Duquesne had fallen to their troops. In the advance on Fort Duquesne, Brigadier General John Forbes made his way, like Braddock before him, with difficulty over the mountains, divided his force, and with 2,500 picked men, pushed on for the assault. Washington led the vanguard and, unlike Braddock, made extensive use of scouting parties. But this time there was nothing to fear. The French commander had already abandoned the stronghold, blowing up his magazines and retreating down the Ohio River by the light of the flames. On the 28th, the British-American forces marched in. The fortress was refortified and garrisoned. Its name was changed to Fort Pitt, in honor of William Pitt, and it became the nucleus of the future community of Pittsburgh. So ended the campaign of 1758. The French had held their own at Ticonderoga, but their left and right flanks had been forced back. Time for them was running out. At the end of July 1759, Fort Niagara on New York's western frontier was captured by Sir William Johnson and his Iroquois allies, and the French bastions at Crown Point and Ticonderoga finally fell to Lord Amherst, which opened the way northward to the French provincial capital of Quebec. The battle for Quebec was the decisive battle of the war. The city, an almost impregnable stronghold, was the Gibraltar of America. Standing upon the crest of a monumental headland that thrust out into the St. Lawrence River, it had an upper city, naturally defended by steep bluffs, and a lower city, ringed by forts. Below the town lay the St. Charles River, considered unfordable and defended by a bridgehead. A boom of logs obstructed the river's mouth, and this boom in turn was guarded by a battery of heavy guns resting on three sunken ships. Earthworks had also been thrown up along the shore on either side. On June 26, a fleet bearing a British army of 9,000 men under General Wolfe anchored just south of Quebec City. The French General Montcalm, in charge of the city's defense, had at his disposal 7,000 troops, mostly Canadian militia, as well as Indian auxiliaries. But he not unreasonably expected that if Wolfe dared to attack, it would be through the lower city, and so that was where he kept his main force. Wolfe laid siege, but from the end of June to the 12th of September made little headway. He bombarded the French from his frigates and islands in the stream, and managed to run several vessels past the French artillery that swept the riverfront. But when he attempted to attack the French left, he was repulsed with heavy losses. One afternoon, however, he spied through his telescope a goat trail leading up to the Plains of Abraham, the heights above the town. The trail was defended by about 100 men, an adequate force for such a narrow defile. But early in the morning of September 13, 24 British commandos caught them napping. Within a few hours, 3,200 British soldiers had clambered up to the heights, dragging a cannon after them. To face them, Montcalm brought out two cannon and 5,000 men. The day before, an ailing Wolfe had told his doctor, "I know perfectly well you cannot cure me, but pray make me up so that I may be without pain for a few days and able to do my duty. That is all I want." As he had come down the river on the ebb tide to the path up to the heights, he had recited Thomas Gray's elegy in a country churchyard. One way or another, he knew he was going to die. The plains were a level tract of grass commanding the town, and at the place Wolfe chose for his battlefield, less than a mile wide. Between the plains and Quebec itself was a wooded hill. The first French soldiers appeared on its summit at about 6 o'clock. The British were in line and waiting. At Wolfe's command, each soldier loaded his musket with two balls. The French charged. The British came forward as if to meet them, then halted and stood still. When the French had come to within 40 yards, the British fired. The French line broke. The British charged and drove them back in a rout. Both Wolfe and Montcalm were mortally wounded in the action, which was remarkably brief. As Wolfe lay dying, an aide exclaimed, "They run! See how they run!" "Who run?" Wolfe asked in a daze. "The enemy, sir! They give way everywhere!" Wolfe whispered, "God be praised. I will die in peace." His equally gallant adversary was laid to rest in a rough coffin lowered into a crater made by a British shell. The remnants of the French army abandoned Quebec and fell back to Montreal, where they held out for another year. But in August 1760, Lord Amherst brought an overpowering army to its gates, and on September 7, he received the garrison's unconditional surrender. Meanwhile, in the wider sphere of action, the English had driven the French from all of their East Indian possessions and part of their North African claims, had captured Grenada, Guadeloupe, Dominica, Martinique, St. Lucia, and St. Vincent in the West Indies, and had devastated the French merchant marine. Spain, out of fear of English domination, had entered the war on the side of France in 1761, but at great cost to herself and too late to rescue her ally. In 1762, Spanish Cuba and the Philippines fell to British troops. Peace negotiations were opened in Paris, and on February 10, 1763, Canada and its dependencies passed by the stroke of a pen to the British crown. The British returned the West Indian islands of St. Lucia, Martinique, and Guadeloupe, but kept the rest that they had captured. Spain agreed to cede Florida, but recovered Cuba and the Philippines in a similar exchange. Nothing remained of the great French dominion in North America but a pair of little islands off the coast of Newfoundland where French fishermen could dry their nets. All this made England preeminent among the maritime and colonial powers. David Garrick, the noted actor, rejoiced in a celebratory masque. "Great Britain shall triumph, her ships plow the sea. Her standard is justice, her watchword, be free. Then cheer up, my lads, with one heart let us sing, our soldiers, our sailors, our statesmen, our king. Heart of oak are our ships, jolly tars are our men, We always are ready. Steady, boys, steady. We'll fight and we'll conquer again and again. Yet there were many intimations of mortality in the way the deal had been cut. Many Britons were unhappy with the territorial swap and thought England had needlessly relinquished many gains. "We retain nothing," exclaimed Pitt with considerable exaggeration, "although we have conquered everything. By our concessions, we have given France the means of recovering her prodigious losses and of becoming once more formidable to us at sea." In this, he would turn out to be right. At the same time, but with less perspicacity, a surprising number were in favor of returning Canada, which they regarded as a wintry wasteland, to France in exchange for the tiny but sugar-rich island of Guadeloupe. Before long, Garrick's proud and optimistic chant was drowned out by verses like these. "Britannia, mistress of the world no more, by foes deluded, by false friends betrayed, and rifled of the spoils her conquests made, cursed with a treaty whose unequal terms check in mid-progress her victorious arms." But in the American colonies, there were no such misgivings. From New England to the Carolinas, Americans lit bonfires, rang bells, fired off their guns in celebration, threw festive banquets, and marched in parades. Protestant clergymen joined in the rejoicing, but also looked upon the French defeat in biblical terms. "God has given us to sing this day the downfall of New France, the North American Babylon, New England's rival," proclaimed Eli Forbes to his congregation in Brookfield, Massachusetts. "Methinks I see towns enlarged, settlements increased, and this howling wilderness become a fruitful field which the Lord hath blessed. And, to complete the scene, I see churches rise and flourish in every Christian grace where has been the seat of Satan and Indian idolatry." European diplomats saw something else, that the completeness of the British victory carried with it the germs of the disintegration of the king's empire in America. As long as France had threatened the colonies, they had looked to the mother country for support and leadership, being unable to muster themselves to a common defense. But once the threat was passed, what was to prevent them from going their own way? Montcalm himself, before the Battle of Quebec, had predicted not only his own defeat, but its great aftermath in colonial rebellion. "I console myself," he said, "that in my defeat and in her conquest, England will find a tomb. And far away in Constantinople, the Comte de Vergennes, then French ambassador to the court of the Ottoman Turks, wrote with remarkable prescience, 'The colonies will no longer need Britain's protection. She will call on them to contribute toward supporting the burdens they have helped to bring on her, and they will answer by striking off their chains.'" 12 years later, as French foreign minister, Vergennes would emerge as the architect of his government's pro-American policy during the Revolutionary War. Whether the colonists themselves clearly understood their own situation is a question. Benjamin Franklin, the most worldly wise of them, perhaps, believed, or affected to believe, that the colonies were so jealous of one another that they would never unite against their mother country. If they could not agree to unite against the French and Indians, can it reasonably be supposed that there is any danger of their uniting against their own nation, which it is well known they all love much more than they love one another? I will venture to say union amongst them for such a purpose is not merely improbable, it is impossible. Unless, he added, they are made to feel the most grievous tyranny and oppression. Chapter 2. The Colonial World. It was a commonplace of the discourse of empire to speak of Britain as the mother country and of her colonies as children, and this had been the case for some time. For the most part, such familial language was used with affection, but beginning in 1765, a satirical or recalcitrant vein crept in, as in a ballad written by Benjamin Franklin himself called The Mother Country. We have an old mother that peevish has grown. She snubs us like children that scarce walk alone. She forgets we're grown up and have sense of our own, which nobody can deny, deny, which nobody can deny. If we don't obey orders, whatever the case, she frowns and she chides, and she loses all patience, and sometimes she hits us a slap in the face, which nobody can deny, etc. Her orders so odd are, we often suspect, that age has impaired her sound intellect. But still an old mother should have due respect, which nobody can deny, etc. Let's bear with her humors as well as we can, but why should we bear the abuse of her man? When servants make mischief, they earn the rattan, which nobody can deny, etc. Know too, ye bad neighbors who aim to divide the sons from the mother, that still she's our pride, and if ye attack her, we're all of her side, which nobody can deny, etc. We'll join in her lawsuits to baffle all those who, to get what she has, will be often her foes, for we know it must all be our own when she goes, which nobody can deny, deny, which nobody can deny. Franklin's ballad expressed a conditionally defiant but still loyal attitude to England, with a clear warning to the French. Nevertheless, it also seemed to predict a time of independence, when the colonies, like children upon the demise of their parents, would claim their just inheritance. 2 years later, Pennsylvania lawyer John Dickinson, in one of his famous Letters from a Pennsylvania Farmer, more sheepishly advised his compatriots, "Let us behave like dutiful children who have received unmerited blows from a beloved parent. Let us complain to our parent, but let our complaints speak at the same time the language of affection and veneration." English statesmen favored the same metaphor, for example, Lord Chatham, William Pitt. "I love the Americans because they love liberty, and I love them for the noble efforts they made in the last war, but they must be subordinate. In all laws relating to trade and navigation especially, this is the mother country. They are the children. They must obey, and we prescribe." Almost no one in America at the end of the French and Indian War would have disagreed, despite some grumbling. The colonies were joined to Britain in a triple kinship of laws, language, and blood, as Francis Parkman put it, and it would be only after a decade of intermittent but escalating disagreement that Americans would come to believe that a most grievous tyranny and oppression had descended upon their lives. By the time the British had prevailed over the French, English settlement in America was almost 200 years old. In 1585, Sir Walter Raleigh had started a colony at Roanoke Island off the North Carolina coast, but it had ended mysteriously when 150 colonists had disappeared without a trace, leaving nothing but the word Croatan, the name of a local Indian tribe, carved on a tree. In April 1607, Captain John Smith had sailed into Hampton Roads and founded Jamestown, Virginia, with a fort, a storehouse, a row of huts, and a church. "For the last," he vividly tells us, "we did hang an awning, which is an old sail, to three or four trees to shadow us from the sun. Our walls were rails of wood, our seats unhewed trees till we cut planks, our pulpit a bar of wood nailed to two neighboring trees. In foul weather we shifted into an old rotten tent. This was our church, till we built a homely thing like a barn." 13 years later, in December 1620, 200 English settlers disembarked from the Mayflower on the Massachusetts coast at Plymouth Rock. They clung with tenacity to their rock-bound shore, building a fort and a watchtower on Burial Hill. Though more than half died of cold and scurvy that first winter, the settlement survived and grew. Since that time, 13 colonies had been established in America, most during the 17th century, but the latest, Georgia, in 1732, with 2.5 to 3 million inhabitants, including 500,000 African slaves. On the whole, they formed a diverse group of political, ethnic, and religious entities that occupied the length of the eastern seaboard, with settlements extending westward to the Appalachian Mountains. although all to varying degrees had representative governments and subscribed to English law. In most instances, there was a royal governor appointed by the crown, an upper nominated house, and an elected assembly representing the various districts and towns. Their political evolution, as derived from the dates and circumstances of their origin, had followed various courses. In New England and Virginia, for example, the representative assemblies were more powerful and fully constitutional, as a counterweight to the governor's royal prerogative, than in Maryland, Georgia, and the Carolinas, where such institutions were incomplete. Both the New England colonies and Pennsylvania had been founded by those seeking religious freedom. Others had developed from strategic ventures or proprietary grants. New York, originally New Netherlands, had begun primarily as a commercial enterprise launched by the Dutch West India Company in 1623. Maryland had been founded in 1632, in part as a refuge for Catholics. Georgia, a century later, as a repository for convicts and debtors, but also as a buffer between South Carolina and the Spanish settlements in Florida. Nevertheless, over time, the colonies had more or less associated themselves into three groups: the New England colonies, Massachusetts, Connecticut, Rhode Island, and New Hampshire, with the still unincorporated territories of Vermont and Maine; the middle colonies, New York, New Jersey, Delaware, and Pennsylvania; and the southern colonies, Virginia, Maryland, North and South Carolina, and Georgia. There was little commerce or communication among them, and regional differences, conflicting economic interests, and boundary disputes kept them apart. The New England economies were based on farming, coastal fishing, some manufacturing, such as shipbuilding, and seaborne trade. The middle colonies depended primarily on farming and cottage industries, especially Old World crafts, while the economic life of the South revolved around large cash crops such as tobacco in Virginia and Maryland and rice in the Carolinas. Proportionately more productive and profitable per acre than maize, wheat, or oats, the major grains, tobacco had come to predominate even in Georgia, where the intention of the original colonists had been to cultivate silkworms and grapes. Intercolony trade was modest, but the foreign trade carried on by some of the colonies was fairly large. By 1700, Virginia and Maryland were exporting annually more than 300,000 pounds worth of tobacco to England, as well as a good deal of sugar and rice, while New England had begun to develop strong trading ties with southern Europe and the West Indies. Pennsylvania, in turn, carried on a surprisingly extensive trade, wrote Andrew Burnaby, a young English candidate for holy orders who traveled through the colonies in 1759-1760, to Great Britain, the West Indies, every part of North America, the Madeiras, Lisbon, Cadiz, Holland, Africa, the Spanish Main, and several other places, exclusive of what is illicitly carried on to Cape Francois and Monte Cristo. By the 1760s, the colonies accounted for close to 12% of British imports, a quarter of her domestic exports, and a tenth of her re-exports to other lands. Imports were mostly items manufactured in England, with the superfluities and luxuries of life. There was competition among the great cities. Boston's fleet of seagoing vessels ranked third in the English-speaking world, exceeded only by those of London and Bristol. But by the time of the Revolution, Philadelphia had surpassed Boston in size and, after London, was the second city of the empire. On the other hand, New York was considered the geographical and military fulcrum of British colonial power. Bostonians regarded their own town as the most civilized of the great ports, or at least as more civil than Philadelphia or New York. New Yorkers, then as now, tended to talk very loud, very fast, and all together, complained one Bostonian, who also wrote that Philadelphia, for all its grandeur, lacked taste and style and was governed by inferior laws. Philadelphia's grandeur was all its own. William Penn had conceived it as a green country town which may never be burnt, and had laid it out in a grid, with each house placed in the middle of a large lot, so as to leave ground on either side for gardens or orchards or fields. It had neat, wide, tree-lined streets that were straight as a string, with wide sidewalks for pedestrians and many fine brick houses, some with handsome painted awnings and second-story balconies, where oftentimes the men sit in a cool habit and smoke. Many of the streets were paved and diligently cleaned by a sanitation department that carted away the refuse. At night they were lit by street lamps and patrolled by constables. By the end of the colonial period, Philadelphia had 40,000 inhabitants, almost twice the number of New York. New York, the next in size with a population of 25,000, occupied the southern end of Manhattan Island, and in 1770 extended only to about Catherine and Reed Streets. At the island's southern tip stood the main battery, a great half-moon or semicircular rampart facing out upon the water and mounted with 56 great guns. At the opposite end of town was the common. Connecting the two was the wide, paved central thoroughfare of Broadway, lined on both sides with regularly spaced young poplars and elms. To the north lay farmlands, marshes, and woods. Most of the side streets were narrow, meandering, and poorly paved, leading to the Hudson or East Rivers, but there were sidewalks as far as Vesey Street, and a few street lamps on posts had recently been installed. Most areas of New York, however, were required to have a lantern and candle hung on a pole from every seventh house. The watchman repeatedly called out, "Lanthorn and a whole candlelight, hang out your lights." He was also an auxiliary policeman, or rattle watch, so called because he carried a large rattle or clopper, which he would strike to frighten thieves away. All night long he announced the hour and the weather. 1 o'clock and fair winds, or 5 o'clock and cloudy skies. Regular policemen, or constables, carried black staves 6 feet long, tipped with brass. Unlike in Philadelphia, many of the houses in New York were set wall to wall like tenements, without a surrounding firebreak, and as yet the city had no system of water supply, though a large public well was being built at Broadway and Chambers Street, from which an engine was to pump water to residents through wooden pipes. There was also no fire department, but in New York, as well as Boston, each family owned fire buckets made of heavy leather and embossed with the owner's name, which were kept in a nearby church. When a fire broke out, local residents would form a double line to the nearest river and pass the buckets to and from the blaze. In one way or another, the colonies had been trying to unite since 1643, when the four New England colonies had signed articles for mutual defense against invasion by Indians or any other hostile force. In 1696, William Penn had suggested the formation of a colonial Congress with a commissioner appointed by the king as executive officer. 5 years later, three regional confederations had also been proposed, but without result. Although the British often complained of the lack of coordination among the colonies in such matters as defense, they also discouraged concerted effort out of fear that some dangerous union, as one royal governor of Pennsylvania put it, be formed. In 1754, however, the British authorities, as represented by the London Board of Trade, called a conference at Albany, New York, to try to get the colonies to unite at least on their Indian affairs. Benjamin Franklin, who went as a delegate, was an ardent champion of the idea. 3 years before, he had told a friend that he found it a very strange thing if six nations of ignorant savages, meaning the Iroquois Confederacy, should be capable of forming a scheme for such a union, yet a like union should be impracticable for 10 or 12 English colonies. In May 1754, the Pennsylvania Gazette had printed his famous woodcut of a snake broken into 8 pieces, each piece labeled with initials N.E., N.Y., N.J., P., M., V., N.C., S.C., with the caption, "Join or Die." "Everybody cries, a union is absolutely necessary," he wrote, "but when they come to the manner and form of the union, their weak noddles are presently distracted. So if ever there be a union, it must be formed at home by the ministry and parliament." A month later, he set off for the Albany Conference, where he presented a plan that guaranteed local self-government to each colony and provided for a federal council of representatives chosen by the colonial assemblies under a governor-general with executive powers appointed by the crown. The conference endorsed it, but in the end it found favor with neither the colonial assemblies to which it was submitted, which were jealous of their own independence, nor the officials in London, who preferred a union of a less popular sort. As Franklin later noted in his autobiography, had the colonies been allowed to unite, they could have defended themselves, and there would then have been no need of troops from England. When the troops came, they furnished the reason or pretext for the taxes against which the colonists rebelled. Early propaganda designed to promote settlement in the New World had encouraged great expectations. One pamphlet published in London in 1670 described New York as a kind of Eden, where every crop of grain had a very good increase and all other fruits and herbs common in England besides. The woods were said to abound with game, and the waters off Long Island to teem with fish, seals, walrus, and whales. Local medicinal plants offered the immigrant a complete therapeutic range. Many are of the opinion, and the natives do affirm, that there is no disease common to the country, but may be cured. As for the Indians, there was nothing to fear. There are now but few upon the island, and it hath been generally observed, claimed the pamphlet with a terrible condescension, that where the English come to settle, a divine hand makes way for them, by removing or cutting off the Indians, either by wars one with the other, or by some raging mortal disease. Those that remained were said to be harmless gamblers or drunks. Other colonies lured newcomers with a similar pitch. Georgia was said to be such a land as nature has not blessed the world with any tract which can be preferable to it, that paradise with all her virgin beauties may be modestly supposed at most but equal to its native excellencies. And those interested in settling in South Carolina were assured in 1733 that all things will undoubtedly thrive there, where wild game already flourished and the woodlands were bursting with succulent fruit. As extravagant or mythologized as such claims appear, immigrants were not always disappointed. For those who carved out a place for themselves, even in the wilderness, were usually better off than in the country from which they'd come. The Scotch-Irishman's backwoods log cabin, for instance, was a vast improvement on rural housing in Ulster, the most miserable huts you can imagine of mud and straw, much worse than Indian wigwams. Food was better and more abundant, and though work was hard, the virgin soil generally gave a good return. So did cottage industry and trade. One Dutch baker in Germantown, Pennsylvania, for example, enthusiastically wrote home after a year that he had already acquired a Negro slave, a cow, a horse, pigs, chickens, geese, a garden, and next year an orchard, and I have no rent or excise to pay. Bounty abounded. Visitors to a Dutch village on Long Island in 1679, for example, were served a full pail of Gowanus oysters, best in the country, as good as those of England, thrown on the fire to roast, some not less than a foot long. We had for supper a roasted haunch of venison, which weighed 30 pounds and was exceedingly good and tender, also turkey and wild goose. 3/4 of a century later, a Swedish traveler noted in his journal, "Every countryman, even the poorest peasant, has an orchard with apples, peaches, chestnuts, walnuts, cherries, quinces, and such fruits, and sometimes we saw vines climbing in them. The valleys were frequently blessed with little brooks of crystal clear water. The fields by the sides of the road were almost all mown." It was a land of opportunity. In 1767, George Washington could rejoice in the rich possibilities in the back country for adventurers, where an enterprising man with very little money may lay the foundation of a noble estate. One traveler to the Wyoming Valley of Pennsylvania in the mid-1770s noted, "The prodigious number of houses rearing up, fields cultivating, the great extent of industry open to a bold, indefatigable, enterprising people." French diplomat François de Barbé-Marbois, Another relatively impartial observer was likewise in awe of the overall prosperity he found. The land, he wrote, repays a moderate degree of labor very generously, and he asserted that in a journey of 150 leagues he did not meet a single peasant who was not well dressed and who did not have a good wagon or at least a good horse. The best of our kings was satisfied to wish that each peasant might have every Sunday a hen in his pot. Here we have not entered a single dwelling in the morning without finding there a kettle in which was cooking a good fowl, or a piece of beef, or mutton with a piece of bacon, and a great abundance of vegetables, bread, cider, things from the dairy, a profusion of firewood, clean furniture, a good bed, and often a newspaper. Although some European visitors noted with repugnance the emphasis, particularly in New England, on commerce and advantage, they try to cheat a stranger if they can, wrote one in a typical complaint. Americans had also not yet begun to rationalize differences between the classes in disparagement of the poor. Begging and homelessness were almost unknown in the colonies, and most towns had hostels subsidized by the community which took in old people or those unable to work. As for the unemployed, care is taken, one traveler noted with admiration, that they lack neither work nor food. The poorhouse and hospital he visited were nothing like the sad establishments of the kind he was acquainted with in France. They were orderly, neat, and clean, and appeared the work of enlightened and compassionate humanity. Although colonial society was hierarchical, with a relatively leisured elite, there was a good deal of social mobility, and class distinctions were not fixed. In major towns and cities, such as Boston, Providence, and Newport, there was a substantial merchant class, and the more prosperous formed a kind of local aristocracy, as did the great landowners and merchants in the South, but there was no titled nobility, and the typical farmer owned rather than rented his land. The artisan, though distinguishable from his superior by his rougher garb, also had the given right to discard it. Except for slaves and indentured servants, most Americans also had a life in local politics. Generally speaking, only those with property were allowed to vote, but by property was often meant, as defined by the Virginia legislature in 1670, such as by their estates, real or personal, have interest enough to tie them to the endeavor of the public good. In America, there were few without some property in that sense. Royal officials complained of town meetings where the lowest mechanics could discuss the most important points of government with the utmost freedom. Or, as a less hostile observer remarked, each individual has an equal liberty of delivering his opinion and is not liable to be silenced or browbeaten by a richer or greater townsman than himself, and each vote weighs equally whether that of the highest or lowest inhabitant. Nevertheless, some were more equal than others, and the practice of democracy was more evident in the North and the Middle colonies than in the South. In the North, there were few great landowners, and therefore nothing like the clear disparity of wealth and social division that existed in Virginia and Maryland, for example, between laborers and the stupendously propertied manorial lords. The inhabitants of New Jersey were said to enjoy a near equality of wealth because most townships divided and then again subdivided their land into 200 and 300 separate, proper, creditable estates. Moreover, northern gentlemen, in the first rank of dignity and quality, associate freely and commonly with farmers and mechanics, though they be poor and industrious. In such a milieu, ingenuity and industry were the strongest and most approved recommendations to a man. Foreigners, indeed, were struck by the dignity of labor, that is, by the respect with which laborers were held. "No form of activity is considered ignoble here," wrote a visitor, "as long as it is useful to society." In the North, master and servant often ate at the same table, shared each other's conversation and society in the parlor of the home, and, the gentlemen setting a laborious example to their domestics, often worked beside them in the fields. By contrast, in Virginia, observed a contemporary, Such amazing property blows up the owners to an imagination that they are exalted as much above other men in worth and precedency as blind, stupid fortune has made a difference in their property. Yet considering what that difference was, some owners might have been excused for the illusion of their exaltation. "The house that we reside in," wrote a guest at one such mansion in Albemarle County, Virginia, "is situated upon an eminence, commanding a prospect of nearly 30 miles around it, and the face of the country appears as an immense forest, interspersed with various plantations, 4 or 5 miles distant from each other. On these there is a dwelling house in the center, with kitchens, smokehouse, and outhouses detached, and from the various buildings, each plantation has the appearance of a small village. At some little distance from the houses are peach and apple orchards, etc., and scattered over the plantations are the negroes' huts and tobacco houses, which are largely built of wood." Slavery, as a supplement to white labor, was the mainstay of the Southern economy, but it infected all the colonies to some degree. Blacks were bought on the coast of Africa by New England sea captains with barrels of New England rum, then carried on slave ships to the West Indies, where they were sold to planters and slave dealers for molasses. Between 5,000 and 15,000 a year were conveyed to the New World in this way. By 1775, the number of slaves below the Mason-Dixon line exceeded 450,000, above it, 60,000, about a fifth of the total population of the land. Blacks made up one-third of the population of Maryland and half that of Virginia, and in South Carolina, outnumbered whites. Above the Chesapeake, the heaviest concentrations were in Rhode Island, New Jersey, and New York, where they worked under less oppressive conditions as farmhands, coachmen, butlers, maids, and so on, more as indentured servants than as slaves. "They are assiduously cared for when they are sick," wrote one European traveler, giving their situation an overly domestic cast. "And they are well fed and clothed. They attach themselves to their masters, whose children they regard as their own. While traveling, I have often happened to spend the night in the houses of Dutch or Germans. In the morning, the Negro wakes them, crying, 'Get up, master, it is time for us to go to work.' The master gets up, they eat a light breakfast, work together, and dine together like equals. They are clothed in the same way, and the slave can be recognized only by his color." Yet this same visitor also reported that some freed blacks had established their own slave plantations, which they administered with considerable cruelty. It would seem that having gone through the miseries of slavery, they should be more humane. But as they have known the depravity of the human heart in this deplorable condition, they realize that slavery can be maintained only by severity. Perhaps the most celebrated black person in America during the Revolutionary period was the Boston Negress, Phyllis Wheatley, who had been born in Africa and brought to Boston at the age of 10. At 17, she had emerged as an accomplished poet, demonstrating to the surprise of many that Africans were capable of education and refinement. In her autobiographical verses, she interpreted her own unlikely story as a blessing in disguise. "'Twas mercy brought me from my pagan land, taught my benighted soul to understand that there's a God, that there's a Savior too. Once I redemption neither sought nor knew. Some view our sable race with scornful eye. Their color is a diabolic dye. Remember, Christians, Negroes black as Cain may be refined and join the angelic train." And she was proof of it, so many thought. Nevertheless, when her poems were first gathered into a volume, it was deemed necessary to print certificates of authenticity in front of the book, testifying to her authorship. Next to the English, black Africans were the largest ethnic group in America, which displayed great cultural diversity and a tremendous immigrant mix. The white population of Virginia was mainly of unalloyed English stock, save for the Scotch-Irish belt along its western mountain borders. But within the first few years of Pennsylvania's founding, for example, Scots, Ulstermen, German and Dutch Pietists, Swiss Mennonites, and French Huguenots poured in. Some of the Germans were actually Dutch but had immigrated from German territory. Others, conversely, were Pennsylvania Dutch, that is, Deutsch. By the middle of the 18th century, the tide of European immigration had become a flood. At least 14 different languages were spoken on the streets of New York, and at a tavern in Philadelphia, one Scottish visitor found himself in very mixed company. There were Scots, English, Dutch, Germans, and Irish. There were Roman Catholics, churchmen, Presbyterians, Quakers, New Light men, Methodists, Seventh-day men, Moravians, Anabaptists, and one Jew. The whole company consisted of 25 planted round an oblong table in a great hall and divided into committees in conversation. The prevailing topic was politics and conjectures of a French war. A knot of Quakers there talked only about selling of flour and the low price it bore. According to Bernard Balin, new settlers included more than 55,000 Protestant Irish, more than 40,000 Scots, and more than 30,000 Englishmen, 125,000 from the British Isles alone. Some British officials even feared that the mass exodus to America would in time depopulate their realm. Some German princes might have had the same concerns. About 10% of the colonial population was German-speaking, the first wave of German immigrants having disembarked at Philadelphia in August 1683. They proved to be skillful farmers and artisans and thrived at a host of cottage industries, weaving, shoemaking, wood carving, cabinet making, leather craft work, pottery, and so on. In 1690, they built the first paper mill in America, and the Bible was printed in America in German before it was printed in English. The colonies were also religiously diverse, with a kind of egalitarian dispersion of faiths. New England was adamantly Congregationalist, Maryland substantially Roman Catholic, New York and Virginia Anglican, Pennsylvania largely Quaker, Rhode Island Baptist. It all mingled with Huguenots, Lutherans, Moravians, and other sects to some degree. America also had about 2,500 Jews, mostly refugees from religious persecution in Germany, Portugal, and Spain. The first to arrive, 23 on a French ship in 1654, had disembarked at New Amsterdam, later New York, after being expelled by the Portuguese from Brazil. In New York, they established a congregation for worship, and in 1730 built Shirith Israel, America's first synagogue, on Mill Street. In 1744, the synagogue had about 50 regular members. According to a Swedish visitor, Jews enjoyed all the privileges common to the other inhabitants of this town and province, except the right to vote. The Jewish congregation in Newport, Rhode Island, also thrived, and its synagogue was regarded as the finest house of worship in the town. There was, of course, some intolerance. The Puritans of New England were unalterably hostile to Quakers, the Catholics distrustful of Anglicans, though near to them in faith, and the Anglicans of New York tried unsuccessfully to establish themselves as the official church by legislative act in 1693. This did not sit well with the colony's resident Calvinists, Puritans, French Huguenots, Presbyterians, Reformed Dutch, Catholics, and Jews. On the other hand, the Anglican Church in Virginia was less dogmatic and more tolerant than most of the dissenting sects. The ethnic religious mix in Pennsylvania was particularly volatile because the militant Scotch-Irish, who began to arrive in great numbers after 1728 and numbered 100,000 by 1754, despised the pacifist Quakers and German pietists. From their Calvinist doctrine of predestination, they derived their right to appropriate the land of the Indian by force. But whatever they lacked in sweet reasonableness, writes one historian, they made up in strength of character and vigor of mind. Another notable group, the Moravians, were Czech Protestants, originally the followers of Jan Hus, who settled primarily in Georgia, the Carolinas, and Pennsylvania after the 1730s and, like the Quakers, held pacifist views. Their frontier communities were decent, upright, and industrious, distinguished by their emphasis on education and renowned for silversmithing, cabinetry, and other crafts. Their municipal water supply system of wooden conduits was the first such engineering in the New World. Music was also strong in their daily life. Drums and flutes accompanied the reapers into the fields, and trumpet fanfares crowned the raising of a house. At the Moravians' Bethlehem settlement in 1756, Benjamin Franklin heard good music, the organ being accompanied with violins, oboes, flutes, clarinets, etc. Other instruments common to their communities were the bassoon, harp, harpsichord, clavichord, and even trombone. The father of chamber music in America was Johann Friedrich Peter, a Moravian composer of string quartets. America was just beginning to come into her own in the sciences and arts. The first poetry written in America had been a translation into English of Ovid's Metamorphoses by George Sandys, treasurer of Virginia, in 1623. Within a century, native talent had begun to bloom, and by 1743, the first drudgery of settling new colonies, which confines the attention of people to mere necessaries, wrote Franklin, was pretty well over, and many in every province had leisure to cultivate more intellectual and artistic pursuits. America's two most famous scientists at the time were Franklin himself and David Rittenhouse, both naturals with little formal education. Rittenhouse, whose great-grandfather had built the first paper mill in America, showed a precocious aptitude for mathematics as a boy, became a skilled surveyor, helping in 1764 to determine the Mason-Dixon line, made new and improved mathematical instruments of his own devising, and was the first to use crosshairs, for which he adapted spider webs, in the focus of a telescope. In 1770, he completed his celebrated orrery, a planetarium or mechanical model of the solar system. Thomas Jefferson esteemed him second to no astronomer living and a mechanical genius. He went on to become a military engineer for Washington's Continental Army and, after the war, the first director of the U.S. Mint. But Franklin was the man everybody knew. Even before the Revolution, he was already America's elder statesman, and it is fitting to pause for a moment to give some account of his astounding life. The 10th son of 17 children of a soap and candle maker, Franklin was born in Boston in 1706. His formal schooling abruptly ended at the age of 10, and at 12 he was apprenticed to his own brother, a printer, even as he continued to study on his own. Inclined to poetry, he composed two occasional ballads in his youth, one about a shipwreck, the other about Blackbeard the pirate, but they were wretched stuff, he later recalled, in street ballad style. The first sold prodigiously, which flattered my vanity, but my father discouraged me by criticizing my performances and telling me verse makers were generally beggars. Franklin took the admonition to heart. At the age of 17, he left home and made his way first to New York, then to Philadelphia, where he became a typographer's assistant. 6 years later, such was his enterprise, he became the printer of paper currency of his adoptive state. Meanwhile, as he tells us in his autobiography, he had conceived the arduous project of arriving at moral perfection. I wished to live without committing any fault at any time, and to conquer all that either natural inclination, custom, or company might lead me into. As I knew, or thought I knew, what was right and wrong, I did not see why I might not always do the one and avoid the other. But I soon found I had undertaken a task of more difficulty than I had imagined. While my attention was taken up and employed in guarding against one fault, I was often surprised by another. Habit took the advantage of inattention. Inclination was sometimes too strong for reason. I concluded at length that the mere speculative conviction that it was our interest to be completely virtuous was not sufficient to prevent our slipping, and that the contrary habits must be broken and good ones acquired and established before we can have any dependence on a steady, uniform rectitude of conduct. Accordingly, he drew up a list of 13 cardinal virtues with an instructive precept annexed to each. 1. Temperance. Eat not to dullness, drink not to elevation. 2. Silence. Speak not but what may benefit others or yourself. Avoid trifling conversation. 3. Order. Let all your things have their places. Let each part of your business have its time. 4. Resolution. Resolve to perform what you ought. Perform without fail what you resolve. 5. Frugality. Make no expense but to do good to others or yourself. That is, waste nothing. 6. Industry. Lose no time. Be always employed in something useful. Cut off all unnecessary actions. 7. Sincerity. Use no hurtful deceit. Think innocently and justly, and if you speak, speak accordingly. 8. Justice. Wrong none by doing injuries or omitting the benefits that are your duty. 9. Moderation. Avoid extremes. Forbear resenting injuries so much as you think they deserve. 10. Cleanliness. Tolerate no uncleanliness in body, clothes, or habitation. 11. Tranquility. Be not disturbed at trifles or at accidents common or unavoidable. 12. Chastity. .. 13. Humility. Imitate Jesus and Socrates. In this gently self-mocking recollection of his program, he notably omitted any edifying precept to help him with chastity, with which he had trouble all his life. Franklin's sexual appetite drove him repeatedly to Philadelphia's brothels in his youth, produced an illegitimate son, William, who became the last royal governor of New Jersey, and later led to a number of somewhat scandalous love affairs in his old age. When he was still in his 40s, he told his son that it seemed to him a miracle that he had escaped the scourge, which of all things I dreaded, of venereal disease. Franklin set out to master one virtue at a time and made himself a little book to chronicle the effort. To each virtue, he allotted a page, which he ruled with red ink into 7 columns, one for each day of the week, crossed by 13 lines. In its proper column, he tells us, I might therefore mark by a little black spot every fault I found upon examination to have been committed respecting that virtue upon that day. Franklin failed in his endeavor, of course, but it helped him to a certain rectitude and, more obviously, bore fruit in the witty, entertaining, and otherwise wise proverbs and maxims, designed to inculcate industry and frugality, scattered through the pages of his enormously popular Poor Richard's Almanac, which he had begun to publish in 1732. Meanwhile, he had assumed publication of the Pennsylvania Gazette in 1729, had undertaken to learn French, Italian, Spanish, and Latin, began to involve himself more directly in public service, and after 1748, decided to devote himself to science. 4 years later, his electrical experiments made him a scientist of international renown. One day in June 1752, it had occurred to Franklin, who was convinced that lightning was a form of electricity, that by means of a common kite, he could have better access to the regions of thunder. As soon as a thunderstorm arose, he walked out into a field with his son William, let a kite fly with a key attached to the string, and at length observed that some of the string's loose threads had begun to stand erect and to avoid one another just as if they had been suspended on a common conductor. He immediately touched his knuckle to the key and saw a spark. In 1757, Franklin went to London, where he remained almost continuously as the agent for Pennsylvania and a number of the other colonies until the Revolution began. Franklin was also a literary figure of note. His autobiography would become a classic, was competent at drawing and engraving, and possessed musical imagination and skill. In his person, he seemed to embody the emerging diversity of America's new cultural world. Several outstanding artists had recently stepped to the fore. America's two leading portrait painters were John Singleton Copley and Charles Wilson Peale. Copley, a master of realistic detail, rendered facial warts as minutely as a lady's gown, and no one painted a lady's gown more beautifully. But his realism also raised blemishes above likeness, wrote a cultural historian, and made them a Puritan memento mori, an intimation of mortality and corruption. One of Copley's more celebrated paintings was that of Eppis Sargent Sr., 1760, an elderly merchant with gnarled and wrinkled hands. "Prick that hand," said Gilbert Stuart, his fellow artist, "and blood will spurt out." Charles Wilson Peel, who had begun his formal study under Copley, was less accomplished, but his honest if crude coloring and stiff but dignified portraits of revolutionary officers, including many portraits of Washington, made him a great artistic celebrity of the day. Another outstanding artist was Benjamin West, who had started life as a farm boy. Like Franklin and Rittenhouse, West was a kind of natural. He made his first brush out of a cat's tail, and from the Indians learned how to make colored paints from roots, herbs, and bark. Ultimately, he achieved fame as a sophisticated history painter, whose most famous work depicted the death of General Wolfe on the Plains of Abraham. Music shops were stocked with classical standards, works by Corelli, Vivaldi, Handel, Pergolesi, Scarlatti, and Thomas Arne. But America had also produced a notable composer in William Billings, whose New England Psalm Singer, 1770, was the first published collection of all American music, as well as the first tune book produced by an American composer. The most popular instruments in the colonies were the harpsichord, flute, guitar, and violin, and knowledge of the violin or fiddle was expected of any young Southern gentleman, along with proficiency at dancing, boxing, fencing, and cards. Patrick Henry reportedly played the lute, flute, violin, harpsichord, and pianoforte. Thomas Jefferson was an exceptional violinist, and Robert Carter of Nominee Hall possessed a good ear for music, a vastly delicate taste, and good instruments, including a variety of German flutes and an organ built in part according to his own design. He also played the harmonica, or musical glasses, an instrument invented by Benjamin Franklin in 1763, which rotated glass bowls of various sizes on a horizontal spindle in water so that when rubbed, the rims produced a soft warbling sound. Often used as a showpiece in parlor demonstrations, it eventually found its way into compositions by a number of great composers, including Mozart and Beethoven. New York, Boston, Philadelphia, and Charleston all had subscription concerts, fortnightly concert socials, and chamber music soirees. Outdoor concerts of vocal music also drew large festive crowds with picnic baskets to the town common or park. Singing masters traveled from town to town, tutoring individuals or choirs at congregation schools, and singing had begun to find acceptance in New England churches. John Adams described, with a kind of awe, a choir he heard in Middletown, Connecticut. "The finest singing that ever I heard in my life. The front and side galleries were crowded with rows of lads and lasses who performed all the parts in the utmost perfection. I thought I was wrapped up. A row of women all standing up and playing their parts with perfect skill and judgment added a sweetness and sprightliness to the whole, which absolutely charmed me." Not much attention was yet paid to Native American music, but a sociological interest was taken in some of the instruments slaves had brought from Africa, such as the banjo, the barafu, which resembled a xylophone, and the kwakwa, a kind of drum. No American writer had yet come to prominence, although some, such as Anne Bradstreet, Jonathan Edwards, and Cotton Mather, would afterward be recognized as great. But there were innumerable scribblers churning out pamphlets, broadsides, drinking songs, satires, and all sorts of occasional verse. The literacy rate in America was extraordinarily high. Although there was no public education system as such, almost every community had a church or parish school, and most towns had elementary schools for those of artisan stock who attended until the age of 13 when their apprenticeship began. Those destined for higher education usually attended Latin or grammar schools, which could be found in every sizable town throughout New England. Private tutors were also engaged by the well-to-do for most levels of instruction, particularly in the rural South. Many colonists sent their sons to Britain for university training. to Scottish universities for medicine, to the Inns of Court for law, to Oxford or Cambridge for mathematics, rhetoric, philosophy, and languages. But America had a number of outstanding universities of her own, Harvard, Yale, and William and Mary being the oldest. At Harvard and other universities, class rank was determined by social standing, and students from less prosperous families had to perform menial chores, such as waiting on tables. Otherwise, all followed the same routine. At Harvard, for example, that meant dawn rising, morning prayers, and a long day of classes and study until the evening closed with lights out at 9. The basic curriculum included Latin, Greek, logic, rhetoric, physics, natural philosophy, moral philosophy, metaphysics, geography, mathematics, geometry, modern languages, government, and history. In the study of government, the basic texts were by Hugo Grotius and Samuel von Pufendorf, whose theories were predicated on the doctrines of the social compact and natural law. In history, the student began with a view set forth in Bishop Jacques Bossuet's Discourse on Universal History, which defined government as the necessary restraint on mankind's evil passions, and its best form as absolute monarchy tempered by reason and justice. Almost everyone in America read a newspaper. In 1725, there were only two or three in the country, including the New England Courant, founded in 1721 in Boston by Benjamin Franklin's older brother James. In the beginning, they printed little more than advertisements, bits of local gossip called remarkables, and the arrival and departure times of ships. The New England Courant, however, broke ranks to comment on public issues, and in 1735, John Peter Zenger, a Palatine German who had begun the New York Weekly Journal 2 years before, won a landmark court case against the royal governor that helped establish freedom of the press. By the time of the Revolution, the colonies had 25 papers or more. Bookshops also multiplied. Until the 1730s, at least, almost all books were obtained from England, as there was not a good bookseller's shop, according to Benjamin Franklin, south of Boston. By 1771, however, Boston had at least 10 and Philadelphia 50, and by the Revolution, both Boston and New York had 20 and Philadelphia 75. Most, in addition, carried stationery and contemporary prints and engravings by Piranesi, Hogarth, and others, portraits of prominent historical figures, neoclassical landscapes, and history paintings, or pictures on historical, biblical, and mythological themes. Along with bookselling, a library system had also grown up. The first subscription library in America emerged out of a Club for Mutual Improvement formed by Benjamin Franklin, which met at a Philadelphia alehouse every Friday evening. Aside from Franklin, the original members included a well-read scrivener with a talent for verse, a self-taught mathematician, great in his own way, who later became a notable inventor, a merchant with an interest in philosophy, and so on. "The rules that I drew up," Franklin tells us, "required that every member in his turn should produce one or more queries on any point of morals, politics, or natural philosophy to be discussed by the company, and once in 3 months produce and read an essay of his own writing on any subject he pleased. Our debates were to be conducted in the sincere spirit of inquiry after truth, without fondness for dispute or desire of victory." In time, the little group hired a room to meet in, and Franklin proposed that each member of the group lodge his books there, where they could be consulted and borrowed by all. It then occurred to him in 1731 to start a public library with subscribers, whereby members paid an entrance fee plus annual dues. The monies went toward enlarging the collection or paying rent on the room or rooms where the books were kept. In Franklin's initial trial, 50 people were found willing to give 40 shillings each plus 10 shillings per year for the purchase of books. Their first order included the works of Homer, Plutarch, Xenophon, and Tacitus, modern histories, grammars, dictionaries, and encyclopedias, treatises on mathematics, chemistry, physics, astronomy, botany, natural history, architecture, farming, and surveying, The Complete Tradesman, a popular book on commerce, and the works of Dryden, Addison, and Steele, a pretty good nucleus on which to build. The ideas soon spread, And by 1775, perhaps 70 such libraries had been formed throughout the colonies. "These libraries," wrote Franklin, "have improved the general conversation of the Americans, made the common tradesmen and farmers as intelligent as most gentlemen from other countries, and contributed in some degree, by such enlightenment," he ventured, "to the determination of Americans to stand up for their rights." Some private libraries were also substantial. In the great manor houses of the South, a prosperous planter might accumulate up to 4,000 volumes. English and Continental courtesy and conduct books, such as Henry Peacham's The Complete Gentleman or the works of Castiglione, were on every gentleman's shelves, along with sermons and theological treatises, books on politics and statecraft, military manuals, treatises on animal husbandry, farming, gardening, surveying, and engineering, handbooks of architecture, works of literature, books on medicine and surgery, and commentaries on the law. Some of the libraries owned by prominent divines were still larger, and the largest and most impressive of these by far was that begun by Cotton Mather, who had collected as many as 8,000 volumes. Inherited by his family, it was not inappropriately compared by one bibliophile, for its rarities, to the Bodleian Library at Oxford and the Vatican Library in Rome. The development of literacy was furthermore accelerated by the growth of a postal service by which the colonies were joined. The postman in those days was required to be active, stout, indefatigable, and honest, and was expected to report on the condition of all ferries, fords, and roads along his route. He delivered his mail to the local inn, which served as a post office where people came to look over all the letters and parcels that came in. Eventually, milestones were set at mile-long intervals along all the principal post roads to measure the distance from town to town. The ubiquitously useful Benjamin Franklin started this by traveling from Boston to Philadelphia in a chaise with a kind of cyclometer of his own invention attached to it that measured the miles as he rode. At every mile, he unloaded a milestone from a cart, which was driven alongside. In 1753, he also established the penny post in Philadelphia. This later expanded into a system that stretched from the Carolinas to Maine. The broad literacy and political involvement of the people in their democratic institutions helped turn the average American into a kind of citizen lawyer. "In no country, perhaps in the world," Edmund Burke observed in his speech on conciliation with the American colonies, 1775, "is the law so general a study? All who read, and most do read, endeavor to obtain some smattering in that science." Judges themselves, not incidentally, were inclined to decide cases, when possible, in a manner that eschewed the law's arcane minutiae and held to the basic issue in question, consistent with natural judgment or common sense. Although Americans had no professional theater of their own and few playwrights, various troops occasionally toured the colonies, which led to the establishment of theaters in some of the principal towns. A number of the stagings required an orchestra, generally made up of 5 to 10 musicians, and in the lobby one could buy the sheet music for the performance and, at intermission, snack food, such as apples, raisins, and peanuts, as well as brandy or gin. No playwright was more popular than William Shakespeare. At least 14 of his plays were regularly performed, and the most popular of these were The Tempest and Romeo and Juliet. Other favorites were George Farquhar's The Beaux' Stratagem and John Gay's The Beggar's Opera. The first English play actually printed in America, in Boston, in 1767, was Joseph Addison's Cato. This overtly political drama, known to colonial audiences since 1735, had tremendous resonance for the contemporary scene. The setting was classical, like much of colonial political theory, and told the story of a self-sacrificing Republican martyr who perished in his opposition to Roman tyrannical rule. By the 1760s, it seemed to hold up a mirror to the developing struggle between British imperial prerogative and colonial rights. The language of the play became part of the language of political debate, and some of the mighty affirmations of the heroes of the Revolution were inspired by its lines. gods can a Roman Senate long debate which of the two to choose, slavery or death? Act 2, Scene 1. Anticipated Patrick Henry's famous speech, Give me liberty or give me death, delivered on March 23, 1775, and What pity is it that we can die but once to serve our country, Act 4, Scene 4, helped give immortal voice to Nathan Hale in the final moments of his martyred life. Although actors in South Carolina and Virginia generally drew sizable crowds, in New England and Pennsylvania, they had to contend with the animosity of those who believed their profession lured people from their work, induced them to squander their money, deluded young women, and gave a false picture of life. Shakespeare was not exempt from such strictures. In 1761, Othello had to be promoted as moral dialogues in five parts, depicting the evil effects of jealousy, and proving that happiness can only spring from the pursuit of virtue. Still, Philadelphians had come a long way since 1682, when the Pennsylvania Assembly had passed a law imposing a fine and 10 days imprisonment with hard labor on whosoever shall introduce into this province or frequent such rude and riotous sports and practices as prizes, stage plays, revels, and masks. Some of the plays were decidedly risque. The same year Cato was published in America, the first American comic opera, The Disappointment, was produced. Written by a Philadelphia merchant named Andrew Barton, the opera ridiculed a recent local obsession with buried pirate treasure and mixed raunchy language with racial stereotypes. Its characters included an elderly black man, of the Amos and Andy type fully formed, whose lover is a prostitute, to whom he sings a song to the Yankee Doodle tune. Oh, how joyful shall I be when I get de money. I will bring it all to dee, oh, my diddling honey. What would one day become the quintessential tune of patriot soldiers in the Revolutionary War, oddly debuted as the serenade to a whore. There was plenty of other common entertainment to be had. Puppeteers, acrobats, and stunt artists performed on town street corners. Traveling showmen exhibited exotic animals on village greens, a lion, an orangutan, an alligator, or a camel, and circus-like oddities such as a sapient dog that could talk or a pickled pirate's head in a jar. In August 1771, one newspaper, the Massachusetts Spy, advertised a maiden dwarf who is 53 years old and of but 22 inches in stature. She is willing to exhibit herself as a show to such gentlemen and ladies as are desirous to gratify their curiosity for 1 shilling each. In Albany, one tourist was entertained by a virtuoso fiddler who accompanied his playing with singing so high that the whole company were amazed that any person but a woman or eunuch could have such a pipe. When they questioned his virility, he offered to show them his testicles, a couple of witnesses as good as any man might wear. He then imitated the sounds of various creatures, including a cat, a dog, a horse, a cow, and a chicken, all to perfection. Also in Albany, the tourist met a 75-year-old man who could jump 1/2 foot high upon his bum without touching the floor with any other part of his body, the same upon his belly, and stand upright upon his head. Later at a book fair in Boston, he was introduced to a lady who kept a white monkey as a pet. The monkey was just 18 inches long, had a little white downy beard, and laughed and grinned like any Christian. It was exceedingly fond of its mistress, bussing her and handling her boobies just like an old rake. One might well envy the brute, he tells us, for the lady was very handsome, so that it would have been no disagreeable thing for a man to have been in this monkey's place. In the way of popular pastimes and sports, there was also horse racing, cockfighting, bull baiting, in which a bull tied to a stake was assailed by powerful dogs, hare and fox hunts, and the tracking of opossums, the last performed afoot with small dogs in the night by the light of the moon or stars. Then as now, darts and billboards were popular tavern games, along with backgammon, chess, and card games such as whist and loo, the 18th century equivalent of poker. Though Boston set its face sternly against cards and dice. The South favored both, as well as horseshoe pitching, skittles, ninepins, and bowling on the green. Colonial Americans also liked to drink. Taverns were their universal haunt, in part because the tavern was not only a tap room or bar, but the usual lodging place for travelers, as well as a meeting house, post office, mail drop, and clearinghouse for news. The inevitable talk was of politics, religion, and trade. Some of the denizens talked tolerably well, remarked one visitor who made the rounds of such establishments in 1744, and displayed that curiosity which was a characteristic of the American rustic everywhere. In one New Jersey tavern, he overheard a discussion about physics. In another, an argument about sacred history between two Irishmen, a Scot, and a French Jew. At Saybrook Ferry, Connecticut, some country rabble came in and, to his surprise, began talking theology. So pointedly, in fact, about justification, sanctification, adoption, regeneration, repentance, free grace, original sin, and a thousand other such pretty chimerical knick-knacks, one would have thought they had done nothing but study divinity all their lives. Such uncommon learning, of course, mingled always with the common habits of tavern life. Here the time, the money, the health, and the modesty of most that are young and of many that are old are wasted, wrote John Adams in one of his more morose moods. Here diseases, vicious habits, bastards, and legislators are frequently begotten. But in any given locale, even in Puritan New England, there were often more taverns than churches. 30, for example, in Providence alone. They went by such names as the Sign of the Wheat Sheaf, the Sign of the Black Lion, and the Sign of the White Horse. One poignant sign outside Cambridge, Massachusetts, which showed the round earth with a man crawling through it, bore the legend, "Oh, how shall I get through this world?" Some of the taverns resembled fancy hotels, such as Baltimore's luxurious Indian Queen, which had 200 guest rooms and a bell in every room. Others, such as the Sign of the Half Moon in Newport, Rhode Island, were dives. In remote areas, the tavern was often just a simple log cabin in which a rum keg and tumbler in the corner served as a bar. Their usual sign out front was an earthenware jug suspended by its handle from a pole. Although drinking establishments of any sort were scarce in the Deep South, from Maryland to Georgia, travelers might depend on a bibulous welcome at private homes. Some planters were so eager for company and news that they stationed servants along roads to invite wayfarers to stop over for the night. Perhaps the most famous tavern of all was the Raleigh in Williamsburg, Virginia, which had a lead bust of Sir Walter Raleigh above the door. Its accommodations included a parlor, a bar, gaming and dining rooms, and several public or common rooms, including the Apollo, which took its name from a room in the Devil's Tavern in London, where Raleigh, Ben Jonson, and other literary figures had once slaked their thirst. Carved above its mantel in richly gilded letters was the motto, "Hilaritas sapientiae et bonae vitae proles," jollity is the offspring of wisdom and living well. Drinking was copious among both high and low, and as much liquor was consumed, it was said, in the ordination of a New England minister as at a barbecue in the South. Even Philadelphia, for all its Quaker restraint, rolled up an enviable reputation for public tippling. At the Red Lion Tavern on Elbow Lane, on February 2, 1736, according to the Philadelphia Mercury, one regular laid a wager of half a crown that he could drink a gallon of cider royal within the space of 1 hour and a half, which he had no sooner accomplished and said, "I have finished," than he fell down dead. Although drunken and disorderly conduct was prohibited, the owner of a tavern could also be fined if he refused to permit a customer to drink all he could hold. To drink oneself drunk was, in a manner of speaking, the first of the natural rights the colonists upheld. French and Madeira wines graced the tables of the gentry. At taverns, the usual fare was beer, cider, blackstrap, and metheglin, made from fermented honey and rum. Rum and cider were the preferred drinks in New England. beer and various brandies, distilled from cherries, plums, persimmons, peaches, or pears, in the middle colonies and the south. Blackstrap was mainly a concoction of rum and molasses, mumbo of rum, water, and sugar, called a toddy when hot and stirred with a stick which had a knob on one end for crushing sugar lumps. Without sugar, it was called grog. In New Jersey, homemade applejack was consumed straight or as scotchum, with hot water and a dash of mustard. Another favorite was creaming flip, compounded of strong beer, New England rum, dried pumpkin, and sugar or molasses. Once the mix was concocted, a red-hot poker or loggerhead was thrust into it to make it bubble and foam. Its burnt taste was said to be the joy of connoisseurs. Each tavern came up with its own brew. The famous Fish House Punch of Philadelphia was so prized that even after the Revolutionary War, it was said to be held in almost the same regard as the Liberty Bell. Always to be had was rum from Barbados and Jamaica, a hot, hellish, and terrible liquor called Kill Devil by the Dutch. Rum does more mischief to people's industry than anything except gin and the Pope, exclaimed one colonist. My dear countrymen are fonder of it than they are of their wives and children, for they often sell the bread out of their mouths to buy rum to put in their own. The same could be said for gin, for which strip and go naked was a popular epithet, and those partial to the sucker of brandy called a bottle of it rather quaintly a breast of milk. Major breweries were established by the Dutch at Albany and New York, and even the straight-laced Moravians of Old Salem, North Carolina, operated their own distillery. One inventory of their church-owned tavern showed 924 gallons of whiskey, 455 of apple and peach brandy, 137 of rum and 30 of cognac, 8 barrels of cider, and 60 gallons of Madeira wine. For abstemious souls who wanted a non-alcoholic but still tavern-like drink, there was always health beer, a spring tonic concocted from pine chips, pine bark, hemlock, roasted corn, dried apple skin, sassafras root, and bran mixed with hops and malt. Alcohol, as a solvent of sorrows and other ills, was regarded by many colonists as more reliably therapeutic than what their doctor might prescribe. Colonial medicine was a typical 18th-century compound of new science, occult doctrine, and home remedies. Among doctors, there were plenty of quacks. A certain Dr. Thomas Wise, for example, blithely advertised in Philadelphia in 1767 his ability to cure, with small expense and pain to the patient, cancers and wens without cutting them, the king's evil, venereal disorders, without salivation, rupture, strangury, and stone. Town apothecaries and peddlers also hawked or supplied pills and other specifics, Turlington's balsam, Staunton's elixir, Lockyer's pills, Walker's Jesuit drops, and Swinson's electuary of indeterminate brew. Some were of use. On Braddock's campaign, George Washington was cured of a persistent fever by something called Dr. James Powders. One of the most excellent medicines in the world, he declared, after it brought him immediate relief. On the whole, however, laymen tended to rely on home remedies concocted from various plants and herbs according to traditional recipes. They read medical guides such as Every Man His Own Doctor, for those who can't afford to die by the hand of a doctor, by John Tennant, a Virginia physician, which had gone into its fourth edition by 1736, and every autumn they would organize an expedition into the woods to replenish the family medicine chest. Tea brewed from catnip was taken for chest ailments. Cough syrup was made from the roots of the spikenard. A cold was treated with honey and rum. A salve made of lard, resin, and beeswax was used to soothe burns. Smartweed, steeped in vinegar, was applied to bruises. Lard mixed with the leaves of the green bean yielded an ointment for open sores. Saltpeter was administered in various concentrations to treat measles, colic, sciatica, headache, giddiness, and other ailments. Nervous disorders, rather too obviously, were thought to be alleviated by chewing the roots of the nerve vine, and kidney stones by eating kidney beans. And there were those, of course, who relied outright on sympathetic magic. Some midwives, for example, believe that labor pains were cut by placing a sharp knife under the bed, or that a difficult delivery could be facilitated by opening chests, cupboards, windows, and doors. Inhaling cedarwood smoke was said to make a woman abort. Southern wood was inhaled to cure vanities of the head, and when made into powder mixed with the oil of radishes, was thought to cure baldness when applied to the scalp. Great experiences were also promised from its use as a love charm when a sprig was placed in a lover's shoe. Spices such as nutmeg, cinnamon, and cloves were the ingredients of many medicaments, along with rhubarb and ginseng, two of the panaceas of the day. Ginseng was hard to come by. In 1738, it was supposedly discovered growing near the Susquehanna River, but 'tis as easy to propagate chastity in a great city as it is ginseng in a garden, wrote one doctor in pharmacological despair. The common rhubarb, or pie plant, on the other hand, was common in America, but it was not used medicinally. That rhubarb was the Chinese or Turkish rhubarb, Rheum palmatum, which was ground to a powder and administered for the relief of diarrhea, gonorrhea, jaundice, liver disease, and other maladies. One species of it grew in the East Indies, from where it was imported by the Dutch, but the more coveted variety grew in Mongolia and Tibet. The Chinese shipped it to Europe from Canton or through Russia, which endeavored to monopolize the trade. By the early 1760s, small homegrown crops of it had begun to appear in gardens in England and Scotland, but long after its cultivation in America, colonists still relied on shipments from abroad. Sassafras, too, was regarded as a kind of miracle herb. In the spring of the year, when the blood is too thick, there is nothing so rare as the sassafras stick. It cleans up the liver, it strengthens the heart, and to the whole system new life doth impart. Sassafras, O sassafras, thou art the stuff for me, and in the spring I love to sing, sweet sassafras, of thee. There were several antidotes to snake bite, such as the juice of horehound and plantain ingested together, or a potion made of powdered rattlesnake mixed with wine or rum. Without access to such specifics, victims did the best they could. Like one Joseph Brightnall, who, according to the Pennsylvania Magazine of February 10, 1746, improvised remarkably after a rattlesnake bit him on the hand. First, we are told, he took a chicken, ripped up its belly, and put it on his hand to suck the poison out. Immediately the chicken swelled, grew black, and stunk. Brightnall kept his elbow bent and his fingers up. He bound his arm in a plaster made of turmeric roots. To let out the bad blood, he slit his fingers with a razor and cupped the back of his hand. 3 days later, he applied ashes of white ash and vinegar made into a poultice. He became delirious. His arm swelled, gathered, and burst, and he recovered. Brightnall's procedure was dramatic, but medicines, including strong poultices such as vinegar and white ash, were often not administered until the patient had been evacuated, as he had evacuated himself, by either bleeding or purging, to remove morbific matter. Nevertheless, American physicians were less likely to rely on emetics, purges, bleeding, and other drastic remedies than were their European confreres. The compartmentalization or tripartite specialization of European medical practice into physician, surgeon, and apothecary also did not hold up in the colonies, where pioneering conditions obliged the local doctor to assume all three roles. One French nobleman who visited America during the Revolutionary War remarked, "The distinction of surgeon and physician is as little known in the army of Washington as in that of Agamemnon. We read in Homer that the physician Machaon himself dressed the wounds. The Americans conform to the ancient custom, and it answers very well." Nothing, however, seemed to be of much help in the treatment of bad teeth. A remarkable number of Americans were nearly toothless by middle age, including George Washington, who, by the time he was 45, had only one good tooth left. Everyone had his own theory about it. One visiting Scottish physician attributed the condition to a constant diet of salt provisions. Others blamed it on sweetmeats, or, like Benjamin Franklin, on a winter diet of frozen apples and hot soup. Still others ascribed it to the tremendous consumption of tea, which in those days was often drunk by sucking it through a sugar lump. Toothaches were relieved by applying the hot, aromatic, and astringent leaves of witch hazel, the toothache tree, to the teeth and gums, or by applying a hot compress of animal fat and powdered corn. Contemporary dentistry offered scant relief. Fillings were made of wax, lead and gold did not come in until after the Revolution, and in their clumsy extractions, dentists sometimes broke not only the patient's tooth, but his jaw. False teeth or dentures were carved from elephant or hippopotamus tusks, or constructed from the teeth of animals such as sheep. These were fastened to their neighbors with silk thread or gold or silver wire. The choice, to some degree, was a matter of style, a reminder that colonial America, despite our Puritan ideas of it, was mindful of fashion and not particularly dour. Typical garb for a man was a shirt and doublet, knee breeches, and stockings. For a woman, a shift or full-length sleeved garment like a nightgown, and a petticoat or skirt. But many Southern and some New England ladies favored silk, embroidery, slashed garments, and lace. There was also a style of dress called a trollop, which had stiff stays and hoops so large that the wearer was obliged to wiggle, bend, and point to maneuver herself sideways through a door. But North and South, it was not uncommon to see colonial ladies of fashion go about in long-armed kid gloves, high-heeled shoes, elegant bonnets, and leather pumps. Their male counterparts, not to be outdone, wore stiff silk coats lined with buckram, sleeves with long cuffs weighted down with bits of lead, white silk stockings, lace pumps fastened with silver buckles, and long queues or hairpieces tied up behind. Such hairpieces varied a good deal in style, being curled, braided, or turned under in heavy rolls. Full-fledged wigs, which were less common, were often bound and braided with colored ribbon. Some colonials, such as George Washington, powdered their natural hair after soaking it first in oil or pomatum to make the powder stick. The backwoods dandy made the best of his situation, with Indian-style moccasins heavily decorated with colored beads, thigh-length deerskin leggings fringed at the seams, a long, loose deerskin hunting shirt, and a coonskin cap with a dangling tail. In relations between the sexes, the women of Boston were said to be more sociable than those of Philadelphia, free and affable as well as pretty, rarely prudish, often gay. The pretty, frank girls of Rhode Island were even freer, and premarital sex was not uncommon. If a young couple spent the night with friends, the estimable Esther Forbes tells us in her biography of Paul Revere, no questions would be asked. Strict chaperonage was unheard of, and young people were allowed a freedom not to be known again in this country until the rise of the automobile. There were so many illegitimate births, in fact, that in June 1765, the Church Fathers of New England issued a 7 months ruling that gave couples a 2 month grace period to get married once the woman conceived. That spared their offspring the stigma of being bastards. Prostitutes abounded in the major seaports, and the old riverbank caves of Philadelphia, where the early settlers found shelter, became a warren of brothel-like haunts. In New York, customers went down to the Battery. A visitor to the city in 1744 was told by his guide that to walk out after dusk upon this platform was a good way for a stranger to fit himself with a courtesan, for that place was the general rendezvous of the fair sex of that profession after sunset, with a good choice of pretty lasses among them, both English and Dutch. In the early 1770s, some 500 prostitutes were settled on land sarcastically called thereafter the Holy Ground, because it was adjacent to and owned by Trinity Church. At the end of the colonial period, the growing social freedom had clearly begun to mix uneasily with former ways. The religious life of America was also, of course, by no means uniform. The Sabbath, beginning on Saturday, being measured from sunset to sunset, for the evening and the morning were the first day, was strictly observed in New England, where citizens were forbidden to work or play, or even ride, except to church. In Boston, persons caught walking about on a Sunday were liable to arrest. One French visitor remarked, "One meets nobody on the streets, and if you happen on someone, you dare not stop and talk with him. You cannot go into a house without finding everyone reading the Bible." But when Sunday evening arrived, children rushed out to see if three stars could be seen distinctly in the night sky, the traditional sign that Sabbath was at an end. Then late-night socializing often began. People were merry in vain, and some, we are told, were guilty of more sin that night than on any other night of the week. Connecticut fathers were so shocked at the way their young people behaved that they banned their Sunday evening gatherings altogether, and New York Quakers were likewise appalled at the degree to which their youth lacked the primitive zeal, piety, and heat found in the hearts of their parents. In the South, observance of the Sabbath was often quite lax. The population there was far more widely dispersed, and for a gentleman to attend church sometimes required considerable time and effort. When he did, it was perhaps as much to relieve his loneliness as to be edified. "The gentlemen go to church, to be sure," wrote Philip Fithian, scholarly young tutor to a wealthy Virginia family, "but they make that itself a matter of convenience, and account the church a useful weekly resort to do business, giving and receiving letters, reading advertisements, consulting about the price of tobacco, grain, etc., and settling the lineage, age, or qualities of favorite horses." The parson often delivered a perfunctory sermon above the murmur of conversation, followed by prayers read over in haste, while people chatted sociably with one another in the pews. After the service, they spent time strolling around or at cards and dice, horse racing, folly with the Negroes, and so on, before going their separate ways. From time to time, the religious life of America was shaken by evangelicals, most notably in the mid-1730s and 1740s, when a fundamentalist revival, marked by prayer meetings, confessions, repentances, and hysterical conversions, swept through the colonies north and south. Patrick Henry's uncle, the Anglican minister of a Virginia parish, vividly recorded what their preaching was like. "They thunder out in awful words and new coined phrases what they call the terrors of the law, cursing and scolding, calling the old people gray-headed devils, and all promiscuously damned, double damned, whose souls are in hell though they are alive on earth, lumps of hellfire, incarnate devils, 1,000 times worse than devils, etc. And all the while the preacher exalts his voice, puts himself into a violent agitation, stamping and beating his desk unmercifully, until the weaker sort of his hearers, being scared, cry out, fall down, and work like people in convulsion fits, to the amazement of spectators. And if a few only are thus brought down, the preacher gets into a violent passion again, calling out, 'Will no more of you come to Christ?' And these things are extolled by the preachers as the mighty power of God's grace in their hearts." Perhaps the most charismatic of the New Light evangelicals was George Whitefield, a follower of John Wesley, who challenged his listeners to awake to the requirements of a spiritual life. He emphasized personal accountability as well as a more passionate communion with God, carrying his message into cities, towns, and remote frontier areas where not only whites but blacks were caught up in the fervor and responded to his call. According to Jonathan Edwards, the great Northampton preacher, who was second only to Whitefield in contemporary fame, many blacks were truly born again in this late remarkable season, and indeed the conversion of black slaves to Christianity in large numbers dates from this time. Wherever he went, Whitefield attracted substantial crowds. Nathan Cole, a Connecticut farmer, remembered that as he set out one morning in October 1740 to hear Whitefield preach at the old meeting house in Middletown, he saw in the distance a great mist rising like a gathering cloud. "I thought at first," he wrote, "it came from the great river, the Connecticut, but as I came nearer the road, I heard the noise of horses' feet coming down the road, and this cloud was a cloud of dust made by the horses' feet. I could see men and horses slipping along in the cloud like shadows, and as I drew nearer, it seemed like a steady stream of horses and their riders, scarcely a horse more than his length behind another, all of a lather with foam and sweat, their breath rolling out of their nostrils every jump. Every horse seemed to go with all his might to hear news from heaven for the saving of souls. When Cole got to Middletown, he turned, looked toward the river, and saw boats carrying believers across in such multitudes that the embankments looked black with people and horses. All along the 12 miles, I saw no man at work in his field, but all seemed to be gone. When the assembly had gathered, Whitefield mounted a platform erected for him in the open air, and he looked almost angelical. A young, slim, slender youth, before some thousands of people with a bold, undaunted countenance. And my hearing how God was with him everywhere as he came along, it solemnized my mind and put me in a trembling fear before he began to preach, for he looked as though he was clothed with authority from the great God, and a sweet, solemn solemnity sat upon his brow. Even the worldly wise Benjamin Franklin was so moved by Whitefield's oratory on one occasion that, he tells us in his autobiography, "I emptied my pocket wholly, gold and all, into the collector's dish." People of all sects and denominations were held in thrall, and despite excesses that repelled church authorities and elicited censure from the faculties of Harvard and Yale, the Great Awakening helped bind Americans together with a shared sense of their spirituality as a people and, perhaps, prepared them, in the words of one historian, for the coming ordeal of sacrifice and war. Franklin and his compatriots were not so moved when, in the mid-1760s, the King and Parliament began to preach their own requirements and to pass the collection plate around for themselves. But they were preaching to the unconverted, and when donations did not come willingly, attempts were made to exact them by force. Britain's power, and in particular the naval strength which had made the empire supreme, were based upon her wealth derived from trade. That trade was managed by a complex but coherent system of imperial regulation, and on the whole the colonies had prospered by their means. In the current mercantilist thinking of the time, it was axiomatic that colonies were to provide raw materials to the mother country and in turn serve as a market for her manufactured goods. Accordingly, no foreign ships were permitted to enter colonial harbors. All imported goods had to be shipped from a British port, regardless of their place of origin, and certain enumerated exports had to be shipped first to England, regardless of their destination. In short, by her Trade and Navigation Acts, England sought to engross not only the carrying trade, but the general trade of her colonies, and to exclude them from the markets of the world. At the same time, she afforded them the best of markets, especially for the cash crops of the South and the timber and marine stores of New England. This worked well enough for more than a century, and almost no one complained. One of those who appreciated the symbiotic character of the relationship was John Dickinson, the Pennsylvania lawyer, who in his Essay on the Constitutional Power of Great Britain, 1774, wrote, "If an archangel had planned the connection between Great Britain and her colonies, he could not have fixed it on a more lasting and beneficial foundation unless he could have changed human nature. A mighty naval power at the head of the whole, that power, a parent state with all the endearing sentiments attending to the relationship, that could never disoblige but with design the dependent states more apt to have feuds among themselves, she the umpire and controller, those states producing every article necessary to her greatness, their interest that she should continue free and flourishing, their ability to throw a considerable weight in the scale should her government get unduly poised, she and all those states Protestant, are some of the circumstances that, delineated by the masterly hand of a Beccaria, would exhibit a plan vindicating the ways of heaven and demonstrating that humanity and policy are nearly related." Yet it was not a little ironic that the plan had worked in part because the navigation acts which governed it were largely ignored. The colonial economy, in fact, benefited for so long from their indifferent enforcement that smuggling was almost a hereditary practice in American commercial life. As early as 1699, William Byrd of Virginia had remarked in a report to the London Board of Trade that Pennsylvania, for example, was not precise in consulting what trade is lawful and what is not. The same could have been said for most of the other colonies from that time up until the revolution began. One observer noted that customs collectors dare not exercise their office for fear of the fury and unruliness of the people, and that Virginians as well as New Englanders were haughty and jealous of their liberties, impatient of restraint, and can scarcely bear the thought of being controlled by any superior power. Indeed, Americans in general embraced a notion of liberty that was already an almost occult compound of messianic, historical, and rationalist ideas. Even before the ouster of the French from Canada, New England clerics conjured up the vision of a mighty new North American empire, in numbers little inferior perhaps to the greatest in Europe, as one of them predicted, and in felicity to none. He foresaw a great and flourishing kingdom with cities rising on every hill, happy fields and villages, and religion professed and practiced throughout this spacious kingdom in far greater purity and perfection than since the times of the apostles. The language of American politicians and statesmen echoed the theme. "The liberties of mankind and the glory of human nature is in our keeping," John Adams wrote in 1765. "America was designed by Providence for the theater on which man was to make his true figure, on which science, virtue, liberty, happiness, and glory were to exist in peace." Some of these ideas were associated with covenant theology, in particular with the Puritan idea that the colonization of America had been an event designed by the hand of God to satisfy his ultimate aims. But they were linked in a coordinate or blended way with political ideas of the Enlightenment and idealized conceptions of the democratic republics of Greece and Rome. The history of those republics, which had been suppressed by tyrants and supplanted by corrupt imperial regimes, was viewed by Americans, steeped by their own education in the classical world, as a warning and example to the times. By analogy, they regarded their own provincial virtues, frugality, industry, fortitude, and temperance, for example, as menaced by the degeneracy and corruption of imperial power in London. The most popular play in America, as previously noted, was Cato, which dramatized the martyrdom of a hero of Republican liberty, and almost everyone read Charles Rollins's Ancient History, which traced the sad story of that liberty's demise. As a law student abroad in England, John Dickinson had compared the most unbounded licentiousness and utter disregard of virtue, which he found in London, to that of Imperial Rome. More than £1 million, he reported, had been expended to buy votes in the recent general election, in which, with equal impudence and villainy, an effort had also been made to get members of the opposition electorate so drunk they could not vote at all. "Few people can refrain from laughing," he added, when members of Parliament took their solemn oaths of office, which included a promise not to engage in electoral fraud. "Liberty can no more exist without virtue and independence than the body can live or move without a soul," declared John Adams in a kindred spirit about the corruption of English politics, where luxury, effeminacy, and venality are arrived at such a shocking pitch. Or as his wife Abigail put it more succinctly, "A true patriot must be a religious man." Religion and politics were entwined. The so-called Liberty Tree in Boston and elsewhere, a great elm on the common where protesters met, was Roman in origin and, in American revolutionary symbolism, related to the liberty pole or pike topped with a cap held by the figure of Libertas in the Temple of Liberty established in Rome in 135 BC. These symbols had appeared on Roman coins, in Dutch and French prints of the 16th century, and in English prints during the French and Indian War. In America, they turned up in the illustrations of patriotic pamphlets, and when Charles Wilson Peale later painted his portrait of William Pitt, to the colonists, a hero of enlightened government, he depicted the British statesman in the attitude and garb of a Roman orator, Magna Carta in hand, pointing to a figure of Britannia holding a liberty pole. Ideas and attitudes associated with the Enlightenment gave the idea of libertas a rational and contemporary context. American writers cited Locke, Hobbes, and Montesquieu on natural rights, and almost ritualistically invoked Locke's trinity of life, liberty, and property as the precious and inherited natural rights of all free men. They believed that political authority was, or should be, derived from the consent of the governed, and that its goal was the general good. Moreover, they believed they shared in a unique political inheritance. It was their historical understanding, based on the writings of Samuel von Pufendorf and Hugo Grotius, that the rights they claimed by way of the English could be traced back to the Anglo-Saxons, as depicted by Tacitus in his Germania, who had curbed royal power by introducing a measure of representative government. That had ultimately led to England's unique unwritten constitution, from which, in Daniel Boorstin's summary, trial by jury, due process of law, representation before taxation, habeas corpus, freedom from attainder, the independence of the judiciary, and the rights of free speech were all derived. As described by John Adams, the English Constitution was the most perfect combination of human powers in society which finite wisdom has yet contrived and reduced to practice for the preservation of liberty and the production of happiness. Whether it could really be traced historically to the Anglo-Saxons or not, everyone knew that in March 1628, the House of Commons had, in its petition of right, sought royal recognition of four principles: no taxation without the consent of Parliament, no imprisonment without cause, no quartering of soldiers on subjects, and no martial law in peacetime. And to these the king had been obliged to consent. It is therefore not surprising that even on the threshold of the Revolution, Thomas Jefferson could declare, "I would rather be independence on Great Britain, properly limited, than on any nation upon earth, or on no nation," as the fateful choice.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.